Good evening. I'm Janet Hobby, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to the Menil Collection. Before we get started, if you'd please turn off your cell phones, we'd appreciate it. Thank you. Tonight's conversation between Calvin Tomkins and Menil director Josef Helfenstein is the first of three special programs commemorating the museum's 25th anniversary. In 1960, Calvin Tomkins joined the New Yorker to write about art in long articles, usually called profiles. He began with Swiss artist Jean Tingley and then Robert Rauschenberg. In 1965, when those profiles were published with two others in the book called The Bride and the Bachelors, it redefined what we expect from art writing. In Esquire, Malcolm Muggeridge declared, "This book is an absolute model. Amusing, informed, perceptive, and above all, cool." Through the 1970s, 80s, and 90s, if you wanted to understand the visual world of your day, you read Calvin Tomkins. He wrote about Philip Johnson, John Cage, Merce Cunningham, Pontus Holton. He wrote about Walter Hopps, Renzo Piano, Robert Rauschenberg, Dia Art Foundation. They were the artists, curators, and architects who were shaping contemporary culture. And they were the very artists, curators, and architects who, working with John and Dominique de Menil, were also shaping the Menil Collection. Calvin Tomkins was born in Orange, New Jersey. Following a three-year stint in the Navy, he graduated magna cum laude from Princeton University. From 1954 to 1959, he was at Newsweek as a writer and then as an editor. Calvin Tomkins' books include Intermission, a novel, Living Well is the Best Revenge, the story of Gerald and Sarah Murphy, The Scene, Off the Wall, Robert Rauschenberg and the Art World of Our Time, Merchants and Masterpieces, the Metropolitan Museum of Art, and Post to Neo, the 80s. He is the author of two biographies, Marcel Duchamp, and with his wife Dodie Kazanjian, who's also here tonight, Alex, the life of Alexander Lieberman. Please join me in welcoming Calvin Tomkins to the Menil Collection.
I would like to add to that and say it is an honor for us to have you here, Calvin. Tonight, it's the history of the Menil Connection and the history of your own thinking and writing really overlap in many ways. So it's just a wonderful moment to have you here. And before we start, I would like to thank my colleagues, especially Carl Killian, our director of public programs. There is Carl over there, who has really conceived this beautiful program and the whole series of this fall's programs. So thank you, Carl, so much. And thank you, Tony, there, tirelessly, always in the back, making sure everything works. So thank you all, and everyone else who has been part of this program. So let's jump right in, going to the very beginning of your career. Before The New Yorker, you were at Newsweek.
That's right.
Did you write about art there?
No, Newsweek in those days, which was the late 50s, had no art coverage. Time didn't either. There was coverage of music and theater and books, but nothing on art. However, when I was there, occasionally one of the editors would decide that there was a story on art that had to be covered or that should be covered. And so somebody would be pulled out of another department to write it. And I was in the foreign news department, and I got a call one day to go and interview Marcel Duchamp. And that is really how I became interested in contemporary art.
That's a great start.
It's a good auspices.
Yes, very good. And yet, so that kind of really leads to, of course, this model that you have created, these profiles. So let's maybe go a little bit deeper into that. Did you have a particular vision for your New Yorker profiles? And what was your first? Was Duchamp indeed your first, or actually not?
No, Jean Tinguely was the first. And at that time, I had no sort of overall idea about it at all. I mean, profiles was not a new thing. The New Yorker had been doing them for almost its entire existence. But no, I just was sort of feeling my way as I went along. And the reason I did Jean Tinguely was that I had been terribly sorry I had missed his great work called Hommage à New York, which was in 1960 in the garden of the Museum of Modern Art, in which a very large and elaborate machine, which he built out of spare parts, destroyed itself on cue, or mostly successfully. It had a little help from the fire department at the end, but destroyed itself in the garden of the museum. And this struck me as quite an unusual subject for the New Yorker.
And it was at the beginning of this amazing series that in so many ways coincides with the Menil's, of course, interests. Yeah. So, but before even going there, something I learned from you actually a few weeks ago when we met in New York the last time, you said that actually your earliest contributions to the New Yorker were these, you called them casuals.
Casuals.
Sort of humor pieces.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And do you think this kind of writing has influenced your writing, writing about artists and art?
Well, I've come to think that anything you write influences the next thing that you write, and so certainly yes. But I mean, the idea of fiction and journalism at that point was there was an infinite wall of separation. And this broke down pretty soon afterwards with the rise of the new journalism with Tom Wolfe and people, Gage Halice, where the techniques of fiction were widely applied to journalism. And everybody said this was a really new thing, and a lot of people hated it and spoke against it. Other people thought, well, this is what should have been happening all along. And it actually had been happening all along. There have always been journalists who have used techniques which we associate with fiction. And quite a few had been writing for the New Yorker, Janet Flanner in particular. Yeah. And Joe Mitchell. There were quite a few New Yorker writers who had been using exactly these techniques long before Tom Wolfe discovered them.
Yeah. For how many years did you write these pieces, or for how long?
I think about 3 or 4 years. Of course, yeah. I wanted to come to the New Yorker, and I was dying to come on the staff. And it seemed like sort of an entering wedge.
Good, smart way too. Good. So switching a little bit, how did the Menils catch your interest?
I was trying to remember that. I was talking with Dodie, my wife, about it, and I think the first contact was with John de Menil. Yep. I believe he had read some of my pieces in the New Yorker, and he asked if I would come into the office. I wish I did, and he asked if I would be interested in writing the history of Schlumberger. Probably very stupidly, I felt I knew nothing about the business of business, and I was just really sort of starting out at the New Yorker and was very excited about all these possibilities. And I said, "Well, I just didn't think I could do that." And he said, "I couldn't agree with you more." He said, "I understand perfectly."
Yeah. wonderful. And I believe to remember from one of our conversations that you actually, he was in New York more often than Dominique.
So yes, I met him first before I met Dominique. And also went to his house on 73rd Street. In the company of Leo Castelli and other people.
He had these kind of interesting dinner parties, didn't he?
He did. He very did. Actually, this tie is in honor of John de Menil because he loved solid color ties in vivid colors.
Good.
I never wear a tie, but I thought I would.
It's a beautiful one, really beautiful. Do you actually remember when you mentioned them in print for the first time, the Dominicans?
I think it was probably in the profile I did of Philip Johnson, which was not until 1977. But Philip, of course, was he loved to talk about Dominique and John also. And I think when I was writing about him, or when I was researching a piece on him, I came to Houston because he was working on the Pennzoil building at that point. And we spent some time here. We even went for lunch with Gerald Hines in the top floor of a big office building. And this is where I learned about transportation in Houston. After lunch, before lunch, he said, well, let's go to lunch. And so we got on the elevator and went down 27 flights to the basement and got in his car and drove up around the circle and came out on the street and drove one block to the restaurant.
Famous, yeah. Yeah. I know people who drive from their house to the next. So, over 3 or 4 decades, your New Yorker pieces really charted a version or an interpretation of modernism through profiles of artists and curators and architects. And as we already said, that were all also central to John and Dominique de Menil. And this overlapping is not the right word. This congruence is really is very remarkable, I find. And of course, in her introduction, Janet mentioned these names: Rauschenberg, Philip Johnson, Cage, Cunningham, Pontus Hulton, Walter Hobbs, Renzo Piano, the only one actually still alive, Robert Rauschenberg, and so on. Would you speak about that, that congruence, about any of them? Because anything will be, I think, interesting.
I think it was largely a matter of timing, you know, because when I really started writing about art and artists was around 1960. And this was a sort of a really interesting a transition point. Yeah. Tingley was the first, and one thing sort of led to another, because Tingley led me to Rauschenberg. Everybody told me when I was researching Tingley that I had to talk to Bob Rauschenberg, but because they were very close and they really liked each other's work, and Tingley had actually asked Rauschenberg to contribute something to his Machine in the Garden, which he did. So Tingley led to Rauschenberg, and Rauschenberg, of course, led to John Cage, and Cage led to Cunningham. And so without really thinking about it much at the time, I was actually moving from one point to another along what seemed like a connected line. And that became very exciting to me. At a certain point, I realized I had been very, very influenced by a book called The Banquet Years by Roger Shattuck, in which he sort of talked about the origins of the avant-garde in Paris in terms of a small group of people. It was Apollinaire, Eric a Satie, Alfred Jarry, and who was the fourth?
What's that?
The Duane Russo.
Yep.
And it was four people, but it was the most exciting and kind of enlightening book about how all this began in Paris, the early beginnings of the modern movement. And doing it in terms of four particular people struck me as a wonderfully evocative way of doing it. And all of a sudden I thought, well, I can do this with this group of people.
Yeah, in New York.
Yeah. But it was a very different kind of an atmosphere. I mean, it came out of the very sort of delayed recognition of abstract expressionism, and which was sort of astonishing that it should happen. It was the first time a group of Americans, they weren't all American, but they were living in New York, a group of artists in this country became internationally famous. And their work was enormously impressive and a tremendous sort of shock to everybody. But immediately it became apparent, or maybe this didn't become apparent right away, but it quickly became apparent that the second generation of abstract expressionists was not on the same level. Abstract expressionism took over completely all of the art schools. They dropped all of their traditional courses and began teaching abex, brushwork, and all of that. And the second generation was just not continuing with the exciting kind of work. And critics like John Kennedy in the Times were calling for a rebirth, and what they had in mind was a rebirth of realist painting, and instead of which they got pop art, minimal art, and then conceptual art, and then all of this congeries of things that came later. It was a tremendous a surprise, but in the early 60s, there was such a feeling of excitement about all of these new things that were happening. And it was so different from the previous generation. And a lot of it sort of seemed like it was in opposition to the previous generation. And it was just, it was a time that I had the feeling that this must have been kind of what it was like to be in Paris in the 20s, mm-hmm. when all of these things were happening with Diaghilev and Picasso and Braque and Matisse and Miro and all of the people you have in such numbers here. But it was a very exciting time, and it did sort of move art in a very different direction. And probably it was just chance that I happened to get into it at this moment and to get and to follow this procession of artists from one to another. It could have gone some other way.
Well, I think you're understating your role a little bit, because on the other hand, that new generation, Rauschenberg, Cage, Jasper Johns, in the late 50s and early 60s, they were completely in the shadow of the abstract expressionists.
Yeah.
And so you really unearthed this new energy coming out there. And of course, the person who was sort of the forebear or the father figure or something like that was Duchamp.
Right.
You may be the only person walking on this planet now to have interviewed Duchamp more than once. I think it's fascinating, of course, your book, your biography. But I think people would be really interested, including myself, how was he as a person, Duchamp?
As I said, I was called out of the Foreign News Department to go and interview of Marcel Duchamp. I knew practically nothing about him. I certainly didn't know he was an American citizen living in New York, and I guess I probably thought he had departed some years earlier. But the cause, the reason I was asked to interview him was that the first monograph on his work was coming out by his old friend Robert Labelle. It was being published simultaneously in Paris and New York. And so I had about 45 minutes to look at the book before I went to interview him. And it had all been set up. As I said, there was no art department or anything. So the meeting was set up. I was to meet him at the King Cole Bar of the St. Regis Hotel. I don't know, a lot of you have probably been there. And I got there about 5 minutes early, but he was there ahead of me. And he was sitting at a table. Wearing, he looked very American. He was wearing a Czech sport jacket and a flannel shirt, and I walked to the table where he was sitting, and he was looking at the Maxfield Parish. There was a long mural by Maxfield Parish over the bar that showed King Cole and his merry old men. And it was about 20 feet long, a huge, a terminal kitsch. And Duchamp looked at it and he said, "I like that very much, don't you?" And I assumed he was kidding. Yeah. And I said, "Ha, ha, ha, well." And then as we talked, I realized he wasn't kidding. He did like it. I don't think he'd ever seen it before. Yeah. And. He was very pleased with it, but for a young journalist, he was a gold mine, because every question I asked, they were all pretty dumb questions, and everyone he managed to turn into something very interesting. Yeah. For instance, I asked him, because this is what I'd heard, that he had stopped painting and that he wasn't making art anymore, and I said, well, how do you spend your time since you stopped making art? And he said, "Oh, I'm a breather. I'm a respirateur." And I said, "Isn't that enough?" And then he went on from there into how art, he thought, he decided that art was a habit-forming drug, and that some people sort of had this religious reverence for art, but he said, "As a religion, I don't think it's even as good as God." So, and it just continued. I mean, I was just transfixed with joy at everything he said, because, you know, I was writing everything down. And every question, his answers seemed to be quotable, completely quotable. So he completely charmed me, and I think it was largely because of meeting him that I began to get interested in writing about art and artists.
Yeah. So did you, and so that was your first meeting, which mm-hmm. is fascinating history.
Yeah.
How about his famous apartment and studio in New York? Did you get there also?
Yes, about. About 3 years after the Newsweek interview, I did move to the New Yorker in 1960, and I think about my fifth profile was on Duchamp.
Yeah.
And so I spent quite a few hours in his apartment on 28 West 10th Street. Which seemed in a way a very un-Duchampian environment, because there were paintings on the wall by Matisse and I think Mondrian and several other School of Paris people whom he had expressed a distinct lack of interest in because they were retinal.
Yeah.
Duchamp had decreed that ever since Courbet, that painting had been purely retinal, and by which he meant it was appealed only to the eye, and exclusively a visual appeal. And he had said he wanted to put painting again at the service of the mind. And we talked about this and many other things in his apartment. He was so much at his ease. He was one of the most comfortable people I've ever been with. He was comfortable with himself.
Yeah.
He up until that time, he had had very little public recognition. He was considered a godlike figure in certain parts of the art world, but not with the abstract expressionists. But he was considered a kind of a godlike figure, but to the public at large, he had become almost unknown after the enormous success at the Armory Show with New Descending a Staircase. He had just sort of dropped out of public view, and this didn't ever seem to bother him. He never seemed to have any particular ambition.
Yeah.
He wasn't trying to prove anything. I mean, even when he argued about retinal art, he was sort of amusing himself. He was playing with the concept. He wasn't trying to convince anybody.
Yeah.
And that's the thing that I found all the way through. He never seemed to be in any hurry to advance himself or his career or his ideas. He was completely at home with his life as it was. And that was so different from almost anybody else in the art world that it really astonished me.
It seems like this is part of his sort of this aura, this myth around him that made him even more attractive, maybe, and more interesting, of course, for you.
Well, of course, I think you did. Incidentally, I can promote a new book. A young artist named Paul Chan came to me about a year ago and asked if my interviews with Duchamp, which by that time I had a tape recorder, and asked if they had ever been published. And I said, no, they hadn't. So he said, I would like to publish them. Which he has done. He went back to the original tapes, and he remastered them, and then we worked together on the editing, and he's bringing out his book on it, I think, in February.
Fantastic.
It's called The Afternoon Interviews by Badlands Press.
Yeah. Great. I think there's no one here who doesn't look forward to that book. When I reread your early New Yorker profiles of Duchamp and Cage, I did this summer, it struck me how much they have in common. They are both, and I think they're kind of not artists in the conventional sense, they're really more inventors, especially Cage, I think Cage's teachers kind of called him in this way. They both, and interestingly, I think what's kind of radical is they both believed that art goes beyond individual self-expression.
Yeah.
And I wondered, this concept, is that something you have been interested in personally, intellectually?
Very much so. This is one of the things what I first ran into it with Tingley. Because I went to Paris to meet him and talk with him. He had a little studio up in the Impasse Ronsin where Brancusi had worked. And he introduced me to the members of the group that called themselves the Nouveau Realists. And these guys, they all talked about their idea of going beyond art. They were really sort of looking for new ways of being artists and for using art in different ways. I think a lot of them had been influenced by Joseph Beuys. But they talked about art as being something that that had to be involved more with our social sphere, with our daily life, and of getting away from total dependence on the gallery system. And of course, this idea was very much shared in different ways by Rauschenberg. Yeah. The thing that happened with Rauschenberg, when I began going to his studio on 12th Street and Broadway and spending long amounts of time primarily waiting for him to get ready to sit down and talk, which would sometimes take 4 or 5 hours. But the thing that kept sort of surfacing was his feeling that he didn't want art to be an expression of his personality. The whole idea of self-expression, which I had always assumed was one of the bases of art, he had no interest in it. He said, I think that my work ought to be more interesting than my own personality. And he was working on and his ways of evoking that were many and very ingenious. A lot of it was that he would go out on the street and go on a sort of fishing expedition. He'd pick up things from the street and bring them back and work with them. His idea was that he didn't want to impose his idea or his will or his taste on these objects he was working with. He saw it as a collaboration with materialists. Yep. And this was, to me, this was a fascinating idea, that art could be this other thing. Instead of the heroic artist like Clifford Still's, we stand alone in the desert.
Yeah.
You know?
Well.
This was a kind of art which, among other things, was very democratic. Yeah. It had a whole sort of different slant on how to go about making art. And then, of course, with Cage, it becomes much more intellectually respectable. I mean, Cage wrote about this a lot in his books. And you know, that statement of Cage is that the purpose of art is to wake us up to the life we're living, which is so wonderful once we get our minds out of the way. And so this whole idea that there was this other way of doing art, and that art could be something entirely different from what we'd always thought it was. That fascinated me, and it certainly ran through the work of a lot of other artists. Cunningham was a little bit ambivalent about that. I mean, Cunningham, he was willing to use chance methods in deciding what kind of movements he would make and when, but he wasn't interested in leaving the performance up to chance. Yeah. In any way. Yeah. He wanted the result to be absolutely controlled.
Yeah.
And Bob Rauschenberg had quite another idea. He felt every performance should be different.
Yeah.
And it was because it was more like life.
I think it's fascinating. It sort of leads back to what you brought up at the very beginning, of course, the pendulum going into this to this extreme of art being beyond self-expression was, yeah, of course, also a reaction against the abstract expressionists, yeah, there, Pollock and all these male heroes. It was really the yeah, counter-reaction.
Yeah. Yeah.
So coming back to Cage, and by the way, we had just a week ago, we had a beautiful concert here. Cage's 4 minutes 33 seconds was performed here for the first time. Mm-hmm. And we had Satie here being performed by Sarah Rothenberg, the director of the Camera. It was very beautiful just a week ago. So I think this is still here in the air, and of course we have Rauschenberg right behind us. Coming back to Cage, how was he? He has this, and many of us have probably read his writings, and his he has this reputation of someone being very polite and very easygoing. How was your experience with Cage?
Yes, in a certain sense, he was, as everybody said, he was gentle. He had a sort of a gentle attitude towards the world in general. But as Jesper Johns once told me, he said John didn't like to be argued with. he liked to give his ideas, to expose his ideas to the public, but then he didn't want them to be misinterpreted or taken in another direction by somebody else. Uh-huh. He was quite firm about that.
Yeah. Yeah.
But yes, he was. He was so delightful. I mean, he was so amusing. And this is the other thing that this generation, he was a little older than the Rauschenberg generation, but they shared this sort of ability to bring humor into what they were doing. And humor was a very rare item in the previous generation. There wasn't much room for humor. And all of a sudden, there were a lot of artists who were making things that, in addition to being beautiful and exciting, they made you laugh.
Yeah. And again, Duchamp is a great figure, of course, model for that. Again, so from Duchamp and Cage, two very important figures, there's of course a direct line to another artist, and that would be Robert Rauschenberg, who has remained over the years on your mind very much. Wrote two profiles, I believe, or at least two?
Yeah, one kind of major profile, and then more recently a sort of a follow-up.
Yeah, yes. Not too long before he passed away, actually,
right.
2005 or so. Yeah,
right.
It's a very moving, actually, portrait, building almost on the other one, on the earlier one. But then there's also two editions of your biography, Off the Wall.
Yeah.
What, in your opinion, you've already alluded to that a little bit, but what made Bob Rauschenberg such a crucial and such a seminal figure in American art?
Well, I can certainly say that from my point of view, he really taught me how art functions. He had complete confidence and trust in the process of making art. You know, he went for years and years, a decade or more, with practically no encouragement from anybody. He did have shows. He had a show with Betty Parsons, but his reviews were always hostile.
Yeah.
And he went for at least 10 years this reputation as sort of the bad boy of the art world. He's not serious. He's not out to achieve a masterpiece. And I think you kind of wonder, how does somebody have the confidence to keep going in the face of almost total opposition? And Bob has it internally. He trusted, had such instinctive sort of trust in the way he worked, in sort of doing one thing and then moving from that, being influenced by the one thing to do the next thing, and being completely willing to let this process take him in any direction. He didn't want to control it. And this was so interesting to me. I mean, I've had the feeling if I'd known that earlier, I might have been a different person. But because I always felt that you had to know where you were going and how you were going to get there and have some sort of structure. Bob didn't need that.
Yeah.
His working process was so intensively productive that he could follow it. And he knew that eventually other people would recognize it. That his work was of some importance. And Jasper said once, Jasper Johns said once, when he was working with Bob very closely, they looking at each other's work every day. And Jasper said, said Bob always felt that people would support his work. I always felt I had to do it in spite of no support. Yeah. But of course, he got support very quickly.
Yeah. And in a way, as you said, as soon as Rauschenberg would sort of gain a kind of a security in terms of what he did, he would actually switch and abandon that technique and would go into the complete unknown.
That's what, after his first really big success with the silkscreen paintings.
Yeah.
And he went to Venice in 64 and he won the Grand International Prize for Painting. And he called on the telephone to his studio assistant and told him to burn all the silk screens. He didn't want to use them again.
Yeah.
He was afraid of repeating himself.
Yeah. That's a radical artist.
It's a radical
That's
artist.
That's great. Very impressive. And of course, we have a history here with Bob Rauschenberg, as you know, through Walter Hobbs, whom you, another profile you wrote, of course. Even Pontus Hulton was among the early curators in Europe to really promote, of course, Tangley even more, but also Rauschenberg and those people. And we actually did the last show with Bob when he was alive. The cardboard piece is here.
The cardboards,
And it was only here, and it was, I think it was an extremely beautiful show, and I will never forget when Bob came into and how he reacted to his forebears, like to Barnett Newman, for example. Yeah. That was an amazing moment. And
that's the thing. He revered Barney Newman and de Kooning and a lot of the people of the previous generation. He was not disrespectful of them in any way. He loved their work but he went in a different direction.
Exactly, Good. Let's come back to the Menil collection sort of before we... the name, the Menil collection, is of course often used to refer not just to the building, to the museum, but to our neighborhood, which is about 30 acres large and includes parks. And of course, the Rothko Chapel is part of this neighborhood, as is the Twombly Gallery and the Flavin Space, and until a few months ago, actually, the Byzantine Fresco Chapel. And one often talks about this spiritual element that sort of is that sort of in the air here. You know, it has been part of the spirit and part of the fabric of this institution and its history. Can you comment on that? Is that something that sort of you have anything to say about that? The spiritual.
The spiritual element. Yeah. It's always seemed to me that came more from Dominique than from John. Dominique, as you all knew, was brought up a Protestant, and not only a Protestant, but a very puritanical Protestant, who felt that it was not right to devote a lot of attention or money to something as frivolous as art. Yeah. She had a built-in prejudice against art. And I felt that it was partially because of her conversion to the Catholic Church, and John's relationship, which became her relationship with Father Couturier, that she was able to make her peace with this whole idea that art could be something more than a frivolous pastime, that there was something transcendent and religious about the art impulse. And so it's always seemed to me that that impulse was coming more from her. Mm-hmm. And it made it something that she could give herself to so completely.
I think that's a fascinating interpretation. I haven't heard that before, and I believe it's true. I mean, it rings, it sounds right. Although there's many, many components, of course. Like, for example, this manifestation, or in terms of collecting art, interest in spiritual causes and issues, there's many, many different, many different facets. One of them has more to do with human rights, which is, I think, very important. Mm-hmm. But then there's also this fascinating detail that we have the best collection of Byzantine icons, in the country. So it has many different ways to express itself, this sort of vision or this interest. But I think you touched a very personal point there, which I believe is true.
And it was wonderful to see how this essentially religious impulse sort of took over her life, and how she was able to realize it in connection with work in the art world. It was kind of a revelation.
Yeah. And I think many have reacted strongly to that, because it does reveal somewhat itself in this not just this collection, but maybe even this architecture and the way light has been integrated and all of that. So it is kind of an amazing Gesamtkunstwerk of some very idiosyncratic vision, in a way.
Yeah, yes, I love what Renzo Piano said about her. First of all, he said that she was his greatest client. In order to do a great building, you need a great client. And that Dominique was by far his greatest client. And he said she was a stubborn lady, a very stubborn lady, but she also had a kind of lightness, a legerite, the way she moves through the world, and the generosity of her spirit was extraordinary.
Yeah. Several months after her death, you profiled her. You wrote a piece, your famous piece about Dominique de Menil in the New Yorker, and I quote, from your profile, quote, "She saw human rights, the religious impulse, and the arts as a continuum, the mental environment in which she chose to live," end of quote. You kind of have already talked about that, but it might be interesting to go even more into this whole issue. And maybe especially from today's point of view, because many of us have been to many, many museums, and this this combination of spirituality, human rights, art, architecture, education, really deep civic engagement is maybe at the core of our mission here and of our history, but it's very unique, interestingly.
Well, it certainly seems so. I mean, I think, I may be doing John a disservice, because he was certainly equally involved in human rights and civil issues of all kind. Dominique's vision was so highly personal. I mean, it's one of the things that makes being in this building so wonderful is that the continuity of this personal vision. I mean, it's kind of narrow in a way. I mean, she didn't respond in the same way to all kinds of art. There's no German expressionism, and I guess no Kandinsky either. But what she did like, she had an unerring kind of eye for not the most the most sort of well-known aspect of it, but for different aspects of it. And what you feel, I mean, I think you feel her presence all through this thing, in everyone, even in exhibitions that she didn't actually mount herself. There's this kind of sense of a presiding spirit, and it runs through everything. It runs through the floors that she wanted, pine floors, the wall colors, the fact that there are no wall labels, that there's no dogmatic things to read. There's a sense of a personal intimacy between you and the individual artwork that I don't think you get in any other museum. The pictures are hung lower here than anywhere else, which I guess came from her work with Jermaine McAgee, yeah, who said the picture should hit the tits. The middle of the picture should come right there. Yeah.
Which leads back to John de Menil. I'm so glad you mentioned John, because it is true, he tends to be forgotten, he tends to be overshadowed because she lived so much longer, and yet he was extremely formative, and in terms of social engagement, human rights, civic, you know, role and civic courage, mm-hmm, he played an enormous role. Good. But I believe, I wonder, would you like to, we mentioned Piano. I mean, he's really the only one. Do you kind of keep in touch with Renzo Piano? He's, of course, doing another project.
He's been, has been spending a lot of time in New York with the new Whitney, and we do see him occasionally, and always look forward to it. Immensely.
Yeah, good. Okay, I believe we have a few minutes to take a few questions.
I have to say, it's a delight to see one of your favorite bylines brought to life, so I want to thank you for bringing you here, and thank you for being as eloquent verbally as you are in text.
Now I'm.
Did you hear?
I'm somewhat a hearing problem, so I couldn't quite hear.
I think the question is about genre in terms of comparison or distinction between profile and criticism, that's. I think that's the first part of your question. So if you, and actually it's funny. The first sentence here in this book, The Bride and the Bachelor, is art has a way of undermining all aesthetic theories. Mm-hmm. That's an amazing statement. Mm-hmm. That's the very first sentence in the Bride and the Bachelor. So mm-hmm, I believe you could probably say a few interesting things about that.
Well, to answer the question, I've never considered myself as a critic. I did write the art a column for about 10 years at the New Yorker, but it was called The Art World, and my agreement with William Shawn, the editor, was that it would not be a critical column. It would be a journalistic column talking about what was happening in the art world. But what I think, Joseph has asked me earlier if I had any particular kind of idea on profiles, any kind of purpose or order in how I thought about it. And at the beginning, I certainly did not. But as I went along, I began to feel more and more, and this is the influence of Rauschenberg in large part, that what I was doing was something a little different from ordinary journalism. It was an attempt to have each profile be a collaboration. That I would collaborate with the artist to go on a voyage of discovery, and maybe we both would find out things about ourselves that we hadn't known before. And that, I think, is how I've tried to do it. That it, and it's what's kept has kept it interesting for me all these dozens and dozens and dozens of years. That each one is a new experience, and it is a collaboration. It doesn't work. If it's not a collaboration, if the artist doesn't want to enter in to that kind of collaboration, it doesn't work. Yeah. And that's a long way from criticism. It's a kind of thing, we're in this together, and let's hope we get out.
Okay. Yes. Can you speak up? Sorry, can you speak up a little bit?
If we begin with the premise that our perception of works of art, our perception is enhanced by the setting, as in the Menil Museum, which I think is a quote from you, can you remark or compare that to artworks displayed in the outdoors?
I'm sorry, you can
So the question is about the setting, the context, in this case the building, enhancing the artwork, and how that plays out with art outdoors. Kind of the same thing, no?
Yeah, well, this building, I've always had the feeling that every work of art looks better here than it looks anywhere else, for some reason. And it's hard to tell why, but the question of art and an outdoor setting is highly complicated, and I don't even know what I think about it. I mean, some art, mainly large sculpture, can only really work outdoors, but quite a few of the works of the so-called land artists seem to suffer from the comparison with their surroundings. The big as they are, they're dwarfed by nature, and they sort of lose impact. But I don't know that. There are so many variations in that. There's so many works of land art. We went a few years ago for the first time to see the lightning field in New Mexico, and it was one of the great aesthetic experiences of my life. I was tremendously moved, and that's because of the effect of the work on the landscape and the landscape on the work. It was just a perfect kind of collaboration in that sense. Mm-hmm. And I've also had the experience of going to the Nevada desert with Virginia Dwan to see a work by Walter de Maria. This was in the late 70s, driving for 5 or 6 hours because Virginia couldn't find it. She had been there, had been there five or six times before, but she couldn't find it. We never did find it.
Was it in any book? Was it reproduced? Was it a work that you had seen?
Well, I don't think you can see it. It was a work. It was a work with a square of four very long lines, cut into the high desert.
Maybe one more question. Honestly, I believe I didn't understand. And
I'm sorry.
Art beyond exhibition.
It's about the topic of art beyond self-expression. Do you want him to say more about that? Oh, did the artists themselves talk about this idea of art beyond self-expression?
Yes.
Of course they did. Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. Rauschenberg, he made that statement that I don't want the things I do to be an expression of myself. I think they should be more interesting than that. And I think that is certainly behind a lot of John Cage's thinking, that he felt that by the use of chance methods, which were an absolutely valid way of getting beyond his own ideas and tastes and wants and desires, that he was able to get into a new field of awareness that he would not have been able to otherwise. And that has certainly had an enormous effect on the world of music and of art. You know, there's a new book out, or not so new, a couple of years ago by Kyle Gann. It's a whole book about 4 minutes and 33 seconds. Quite fascinating. And the thing that struck me the most was that there's an absolutely silent piece. No sound is made through the piece. And there have been, I think he said, 23 recordings of it that you can buy.
Silence is never the same.
Well,
we experienced it last week. We opened the doors.
And did you?
There was an airplane.
Yeah, you know? It's wonderful.
So, one last question, maybe. Yes.
Mr. Tomkins, you so beautifully describe your journeys with artists, and yet you've written so movingly about people like Thomas Holton and Walter Hawk. So what is your reflection on the role of curators in relation to artists and creation of a place like the
So the question is about the role of curators with regards to the perception of art and display.
Yeah, well, I think that the curator can play an even greater role in terms of this new vision of art. Because if art is not the expression of a single artist's sensibility, it can be anything, and as Duchamp said, the artist performs one part of the creative process. He makes something, and then the spectator, the observer, completes the process. And in Duchamp's mind, that there was no limits to how the process could be completed, but it was an essential part of the process. And the nice thing about that is that I think sort of more and more curators are not so interested in organizing their own particular interpretation of works of art as they used to be. They're much more willing to make exhibitions which invite the spectator to interpret them in any way they see fit. And this, I think, is a big plus. I think it's more challenging for the curator, but also it can be much more surprising.
And maybe the fact that you wrote about both Pontus Hulton and Walter Hobbs, mm-hmm. who are really sort of models for collaborators with artists.
Yeah.
They were kind of that first generation represented.
Yeah.
And of course we're really close friends with these artists. So I think I think that's a very good end to this. We are happy you were all here. Maybe there's a little chance for you to talk with Calvin Tomkins. We are so grateful and honored to have you here.
And I'm honored.
Thank you.
Thank you.